Welcome, I'm Bob Lund.
And I'm Chris Rivard with Fastenal Engineering.
Today we're here to talk about locking methods, what really works and what just has locking in the name. Chris Engineers is a whole kind of an odd sort. We like to test things, and if there's anything that's new that we haven't done before, we got to test. But if there's something we've been doing for years, even if it doesn't necessarily work, oh yeah, we're good with that, we don't want to change. And that kind of plays into our world with locking fasteners. What do we have here in front of us we're going to talk about?
Well, I think we're going to start with the prevailing torque family of locking nuts, right? So there we have nylon inserts, top locks, and center locks.
And in all of those, you've got some feature, whether it's the nylon or the deformation of a thread, that is rubbing up against or creating friction of some kind between the threads of a bolt and the threads of a nut. In this case, I can spin this nut down until now I can't get it any further because I bumped up against that little piece of nylon. But as I continue to tighten with a wrench, we'll bust through and now have friction on both sides of that thread. Is that essentially what's happening?
Yeah, we're hugging it.
There you go. And a nylon insert lock nut versus a top lock nut, essentially same thing performance-wise?
Yeah.
Okay. What does the term prevailing torque mean?
That means the amount of effort or torque required to actually spin the nut on once that hugging mechanism has been engaged.
So before we even start clamping anything, it's really just the friction between, in this case, the piece of nylon and the threads. So that's kind of a friction resistance that will also keep it from loosening? That's the goal?
In theory.
Okay. In the bolt world, in the nut world, we're tightening quite tight. We may be putting in a bolt this size, 5 or 10,000 pounds worth of force keeping this together. So there's a certain amount of force that pushes back as well. And is there enough resistance from that little piece of nylon to keep our bolted joint tightened exactly the way it was if you throw in vibration, thermal cycles?
Testing would show that no, that's not actually the case, and that's one of those deceiving types of titles inside of lock nuts.
So the nylon insert lock nut or the top lock or the center lock are really going to keep the nut from falling off the bolt into the grass in the case of a riding lawnmower, but it won't necessarily help you keep the load that you tighten to.
Correct.
Okay. I see another familiar animal here on the table. This is a split lock washer. Our group doesn't seem to like these very much. What can you tell me about them?
Well, you know, in theory, again, you've got the idea that that helix is going to be pushing back on your joint with some meaningful force. But in reality, the amount of force it takes to squish that one down is pretty insignificant. So inversely, you can lose most of the load on your fastener before that's even pushing back with any sort of meaningful force.
So if I were tightening and I flatten this out, we're storing energy. Mm-hmm. But if we flatten this out at 500 pounds, but we tighten it to 10,000 pounds, we're not really getting any good out of this stored energy until we're all the way back to, you know, 90-95% of the way loose. So that's the main problem we see with it.
Yep.
Is they're not very functional. If you're using something with a screwdriver, yeah, you might be okay if you're tightening. But as soon as you grab the wrench and you're trying to work with a bolt that has preload in it, the split lock washer really isn't a good option for you. What do we have that works? What does lock?
So there, we're going to talk about things like wedge lock washers.
Okay.
They're a great vibration problem solver for us. They go by a number of different brand names. We also have thread lockers in terms of pre-applied or user-applied.
You may have a red bottle of something or a blue bottle of something and a lot of numbers involved, or there may be a patch where you've basically pre-apply that onto the threads. And in those cases, you've got a couple of different options. Some are nylon, and that nylon will take up space in the threads. Others are an adhesive of some kind, which acts more like a glue if we're going to use some simple technology, our names, terminology. Tell me about those wedge lock washers. What are they like?
So those are two-part washers that come with ramps in between them, and they're serrated on the outside. So the outside serrations bite into your mating materials, and then those ramps effectively lock it into place. So in order for you to loosen it, you have to overcome those ramps before any sort of loosening is going to happen.
And they do a phenomenal job of resisting vibration loosening. Mm-hmm. We can't go into all the detail we need to cover all options for our customers, but there are Belleville washers, which are cone-shaped, and they compress under a load. We see those used in a lot of high-temperature applications. There's some other serrations, serrated washers, or serrations under the head of the nut or a bolt. Tell me about those.
So the concept of the serrations, again, is to bite into the mating material. So provided your fasteners are harder than the mating material, you can bite in, and those actually do work pretty well.
Good. So there's a wide variation of options when it comes to locking or retaining. And from what I'm hearing, it's probably wise for our customers to ask us some questions, to talk to our engineers about what really does lock and what doesn't. And if they've been using a nylon insert lock nut for the last 20 years, you can keep using it. Is it really doing what you thought it would do? Maybe not, but if you haven't had problems in the last 20 years, you're probably okay. How do they find out more from us?
Well, you can always start with your local Fastenal rep, fastenal.com, or reach directly out to us at engineer@fastenal.com.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.